Hello, thanks for joining for another Between Two Cans. I'm Andrew with Cody Manufacturing. Today we're going to talk about nitro dosing into aluminum beverage cans and bottles. I'm joined by my real good friend, Christina here from Chart, and they actually make the nitro dosers themselves. Hi, welcome.
Hi, thank you, Andrew. Good to see you.
Good to see you. So what is nitro dosing?
Nitro dosing is basically just taking liquid nitrogen and adding it to a container to either pressurize the container, preserve the product in the container, or nitrogenate.
Yeah, and so it is liquid dropped and then it expands, right?
Yeah, so liquid nitrogen is about negative 300 degrees Fahrenheit. Once it is dropped, it hits ambient temperature and it starts to gasify. One part of liquid nitrogen will actually expand up to 700 times its size in its gas form, so it displaces oxygen.
That's cool. So most of the times that I'm talking to people about this, it's for still beverages, right? Still water, still wine. And what you're concerned with is that if you put a still beverage into a can, has no problem on a Cody filler, you could fill it, you could seam it, but the cans could be squishy to the feel. And so dropping a little bit of liquid nitrogen into that headspace expands 700x, creates that internal pressure so that you have good structural integrity, good consumer feel to the can. And does it just change the integrity of the can, or does it also affect the flavor of the liquid?
It doesn't. So nitrogen is inert, so it's not going to affect any flavors at all. So you can either use it to pressurize, or if you wanted to say nitrogenate and do like a nitro cold brew, you would just add more nitrogen into the liquid, and then it would adhere itself to the proteins of the beverage.
Yeah. So you can't just take a normal product, add a drop of liquid nitrogen, and then call it a nitrogenated product.
No, it's actually a pretty long process. So you would have to add at least 60 parts per million of nitrogen into the container, and then it will bind to the proteins in, say, the coffee or the beer. And you actually have to have it about 40 PSI, and then you actually have to keep it pretty cold under 40 degrees for about 5 days for the nitrogen to actually attach to those protein molecules.
And so you could do that in the can, but you could also do it in like a bright tank or serving tank that you're getting the liquid into the right condition before packaging, right?
Yep.
You can do it either way? Cool. And why would you use nitrogen instead of CO2?
So we use liquid nitrogen where CO2 is a gas. So it's going to dissipate pretty quick. You can use it to mitigate oxygen pickup because it's going to displace that oxygen. But if you were looking to pressurize with inside the container, you would want liquid nitrogen right before the capping mechanism to have that pressure stay in there.
Oh, and what type of beverages does nitro work with? What do you see most common?
I would say we do a lot of wine, cold brew coffee is big, ready-to-drink cocktails, but even beer to preserve with displacing oxygen. It ends up with lower TPO, so lower dissolved oxygen within the product as well.
Yeah. So a standard beer beverage is going to have a foam cap that's created, and that foam is CO2 breaking out suspension in the liquid, forcing CO2 through that headspace so oxygen can't get in. Nitrogen is going to do the same thing, basically, just take out the oxygen in that headspace so that you have a more enriched CO2 nitrogen environment, less DO pickup, less TPO as well.
Yeah, so nitrogen is actually heavier, so it's actually going to blanket it down. And so as the CO2 is coming up and escaping out of solution, the nitrogen is going to come and put a blanket on there so that no oxygen can get in there as well.
So where do you place a nitro doser in a canning line?
So you place it right in between the last fill head and the lid drop. You'd want to drop the liquid nitrogen prior to the lid just so that it is sealed into the container before seeding.
Okay. So you have a can, travels on the canning line, you fill it with your liquid. The next step is to put your lid on and then to seam it. Obviously, we need to have the top open. So we're going to drop liquid nitrogen directly before the lid dropper goes in and then directly into the seamer as well.
Yep, so it's gasifying while you're lidding and seaming to keep that pressure inside the container.
And for most canning lines that you work with, you have like a stand HMI and then your doser that kind of mounts over the equipment. Is that correct?
Either you could either use a stand and a mount, or you could mount it directly onto the system.
Yep. So Cody has worked with Chart to get it directly mounted onto our seamer. And it's actually on the exact same position as the lid drop, the nitro dose, and the seamer. So you could use one joist jack to change the height for everything. So if you're moving from 12-ounce cans to 16-ounce cans, you get to dial in the nitro dose, the lid dropper, and your seamer height all together at the same time, which is pretty sweet. Now, how does the liquid nitrogen actually get to your unit?
Yeah, so you would either need a bulk tank. A lot of big customers have like a bulk tank outside, but most smaller customers have a liquid nitrogen dewar. Those are about 180 liters to 230 liter. Sometimes they come on casters. You just get it close to your filler, and then there is a vacuum insulated flex hose that would be attached to the dewar and then into our doser. So okay. The liquid nitrogen into our doser.
Cool. So you or Cody can sell the stand if needed, the HMI, the doser, but the customer is going to find the bulk tank of nitrogen locally, right?
Yeah, so usually they get it from their gas supplier.
And if a customer already owns a nitro doser, can they integrate it into a Cody line? Or if they have one on a Cody line, can they integrate it into a different line, a bottling line, for instance?
Absolutely. The stand and base is flexible, and the brackets on there can move up and down, so you can place it wherever you need to be.
Yeah, cool. So pretty much any application that you need, whether it's for canning or bottling, we've even seen it with like dry goods, putting in to preserve. You could use the same doser and move it to different locations, save a little money there.
Yeah, absolutely. There's a lot of different applications. I've seen a lot of food, protein powders, anything that you need to just displace oxygen out of. Cheese, peanut butter, even water bottles to hold the rigidity into the container. So there's a lot of applications.
Cool. And how long has Chart been doing this?
So Chart has been making nitrogen dosers for about 20 years. It was a different company that Chart acquired. And so it's only been Chart for about 10 years. It was Cryotech before.
Okay. And where are they manufactured?
So the doser body itself, where they pull the vacuum out of the doser body to keep the liquid at negative 320, is actually where we make our bulk tanks in Canton, Georgia. And then they send them to Fremont, California, and that's where it is, gives its dosing head, its actuator, gives its control panel and the stands and all the other cables and sensors that it needs to integrate with fillers.
And if a customer orders a Chart doser through Cody, we're going to match it with our lead times and make sure that it all gets installed at the same time. If somebody just needs a nitro doser from you, what's a lead time look like for that?
Yeah, it's about 4 weeks from the time of PO to build.
Yeah. Now, I remember working with you guys a number of years ago, and when you integrated the variable dosing technology. And so the concern at that time was a lot of inline fillers can have 2, 4, 6 or more heads in line. And the speed of the first can getting to the doser location in the seamer had a different time than the last can. So I believe you create a technology where you actually can increase the dose or change the dose over a certain amount of cycles. Can you talk about that a little bit?
Absolutely. So all fillers are different. Some of the rotaries, you know, they're being filled and capped independently. So we have one that can just do discrete dosing. So it's going to put in a discrete amount of liquid nitrogen on an interval that you can set every time. Well, with the inline fillers, when you have, say, 5 cans coming up and being filled at the same time, and then they're waiting to get their lid and then waiting to be seamed, we have what's called dynamic dose duration, where you can actually give cans 2, 3, 4, and 5 an increasing dose of nitrogen to account for evaporation while it takes that extra second to get to the seamer.
One of the great advantages of a Cody seamer is that there is a screw drive, and the screw drive is going to maintain the same timing of the can moving from the nitro location to the lid drop to the seamer. So you do not need that advanced technology. You can use kind of the tried and true long-standing models that Chart has been providing, and it's going to have the exact same pressure inside the can every time it gets delivered to that location. Yeah. What else do we need to know about Chart?
Chart is awesome. So we are basically kind of paving the forefront of using gases efficiently and creatively to help sustain the world worldwide in a bunch of different applications.
Yeah, that's awesome. I did think of another question. We use a lot of these applications specifically for cold brew coffee. Some of the applications use a widget can and some use a widget-less can.
So the difference between a widget and a widget list, it is a two-way pressure valve in the bottom of the can. So it's plastic. So you're going to put the nitrogen in there, and then it has to be inverted. And so the nitrogen is going to go, and it's going to go in one way into that cavity. And so it'll sit there until you actually open it. And then they say to pour hard because you need that pressure differential pressure to agitate to get the liquid nitrogen or the nitrogen to come out and have that cascading effect. So you can do the same process without the widget by just adding liquid nitrogen to the can. And then you would still want to pour hard because you do need that agitation. So you would need to pour hard, and then the nitrogen is going to go straight to the bottom, and then it's actually going to come back up for that cascading effect.
And that's how you get that beautiful velvet texture cascade on those drinks. It looks so beautiful. And so we have capabilities of doing both widget cans and widget-less cans. Obviously a little bit cost increase if you get the cans with the widget, but potentially a better visual appeal to the package. We'll talk to you, each consumer or customer, one by one as to what's best for them overall. Anything else that we need to learn about nitro dosing? This is really fascinating.
There's so many uses, and there is, I mean, displacing oxygen, you know, preservation is a big thing for, you know, most foods. So I think that, using these gases wisely for, the way of the future to make things more sustainable.
That's awesome. Well, I want to thank everyone for taking another opportunity to learn a little bit about nitro dosing. Super happy with our partner Chart, and Christina, one of my great friends. Thanks for coming by today. And
thank you for having me.
No problem. We'll see you guys in the future. Thanks. Bye.